just as importantly is ensuring that we provide the right environment for our coaches. So, you know, making sure that they can actually coach and not all do this administration, et cetera, and having the right support team around them as well. Now, sometimes that's difficult in a club environment, obviously, but you know, with an innovative coach, I don't think it's difficult to be able to tap students on the shoulder, massage, physiotherapy, and ensuring that you have what we call an IST, integrated support team, around you, even at that club level. Now, obviously, you have it at the national level and the provincial levels as well, but it is critical. And I still remember at the Queensland Academy of Sport, we had a coach called Stefan Widmar. I hired him in 1996 from Switzerland, and he coached Libby Lenton and Liesl Jones. And, you know, I must admit, I wasn't paying him very much. He was around $65,000. And obviously, I bumped it up after the 2006 Commonwealth Games, gave him a car and things like that. But, I mean, he did tell me that you know, he's had offers from other countries in the world, but the main reason he stays in Queensland is because he has everything he needs in terms of that support team, and he can achieve what he wants to achieve. So he has everything he needs for his athletes, and you know, I think that hit home quite a bit.
Well, I mean, when Yeno was coaching and Clifford, and in those days, there might have been a paid head coach at the big city centers, but a lot of the small town coaches were volunteer. Certainly most of the rest of the staffs were volunteer. And now we're at a point where virtually every coach in the country is making something.
Yep.
And yet, I don't know, obviously that's a great thing, but do you think that the coaching has improved that much?
No, I don't think the coaching has improved that much. I think that's one of our challenges moving forward is ensuring that we get all coaches outside the comfort zone. And you know, I know there's issues in terms of the balance between, you know, participation and obviously the high performance aspect as well. But really, we can't get comfortable, particularly if we want to compete against countries like the UK, like Australia, like the US as well. You know, I think we have to know what our competition is and what our competition is doing. So I strongly believe in intelligence gathering and really taking a look at that gap. Where are we at this point in time in terms of our times? And I think in swimming, it's relatively easy. And are we actually closing that gap or not? And that's the biggest challenge, because many of these countries are improving significantly. And we're also improving. But are we improving at a higher rate than our competitors? And that's the big challenge we have.
Do you think that you could have been, I don't know about a world record, but do you think you could have been great in other sports, or were you fortunate to find swimming as your thing?
Yeah, no, I think I probably couldn't have taken on too many sports. If you see me play basketball, I think, there's something about swimming and then translating it to have some hand-eye coordination. And there's a bit of a problem. No, I don't know. I mean, I started very early at the age of 9, and you know, I probably wouldn't recommend it. But by the age of 10, you know, I was doing 9 workouts, so it's fairly precocious. And swimming was really the only thing at that point in time. And even though I did a number of sports in school and high school, I just didn't have time to do other things.
Because your situation was also rare in that you stayed with Yeno throughout your career. Like, that was, you know, that's basically unheard of now for a coach to have a swimmer from 10 through. I mean, ironically, Michael Phelps had the similar situation. Yeah. But do you think you and Yeno just had lightning in a bottle for that? Do you look at that?
I did have a year break when I was 12 and 13. I did go to Paris because my father was a professor at the university, and he was on sabbatical. So. And actually, I take a look back at it, and it was a good psychological break because, you know, in France at that time, they were training once a day, and you know, they actually drank, you're talking about wine, they drank wine before the competition. So for me, when I came back, I was again hungry. And I don't know, I mean, if I think of it, you know, did that make a difference or not? Because it gave me that psychological break and let me carry on. Because a lot of people said at 9 or 10 that I'm going to basically burn out because, you know, I had all these national records at that age. And in one way, I wanted to prove them wrong, obviously, and that kept me going as well. But I do think that year in Paris kind of helped me realize that, know, not everything revolves around swimming. Like, get in, swim, do your best, but don't think about it 24 hours a day, that there's other things in life. And I think it's important for our athletes to I guess, ensure that they have a balanced life. And you know, because I still remember in 1980 where a lot of athletes took the year off. Unfortunately, we didn't go to the Olympics that year. But they took the year off just to concentrate on their sport. And those were the athletes that invariably didn't actually make the Olympic team. So I've always believed, you know, there needs to be a balance, whether it's doing part-time university or work, just ensuring that you have some kind of escape, not focusing on sport all the time.
So we're going to bring out Michel in just a second. I have one more question for you, though. Like, as a leader of an organization like Own the Podium, and this belief that compromise is what, you know, can hurt us so badly, how much can you do in leading an organization to try and ensure that the groups you're dealing with don't compromise? Like, how much can you actually do to get that message down the line?
Well, I mean, we're in a fortunate position that we use funding as a leverage. So, but I mean, it's true. I mean, if you have the purse strings, then you can basically put down the parameters in terms of what you feel that has to be done. Now, I strongly believe that sport should run sport, but we have a number of instances right now with, I won't mention which sports they are, but where we need to intervene.
Oh, go on.
Well, I can mention them if you want. Where we have to go in and intervene. And in one of those sports, we've actually taken over their high-performance program because we feel that the athletes and the coaches are there, but the leadership of the national body is not there. And, you know, so intervention is part of our mandate, and I believe strongly in it, although, you know, you have to make sure that you have the right expertise, and if you go in for a certain period of time and then pull out and let the sport run the sport, because I think otherwise you're not going to have that long-term sustainability.
That sounds like a great television show for A&E, Alex Baumann's Intervention. He shows up at the door of some unsuspecting sport and says, I need to talk to you. And they brought all the other sports together, get that sport to sit down and admit they have a problem. That's good.